Um, Brad Austin is professor of history at Salem State University, where he teaches classes on modern American history, sports history, world history, and methods of teaching history class. He and his wife have two daughters, Stella, age 13, and Phoebe, age 6. Phoebe, who is deaf, has introduced Brad and his family to a host of new people and issues related to communication options in deaf education. He's also the president of the Decibels Foundation, a nonprofit organization that provides services for deaf and hard of hearing children and their families. Also, Nicole West was one of his favorite students ever. So here is Brad.
Kayla, I don't think I wrote that part about Nicole West because I didn't really like her. No, I'm really happy to be here with you today. So one of the reasons I liked Nicole, and still like Nicole, is that she was the kind of student who I imagined would be here at 8 o'clock in the morning to develop more professional skills, and so I applaud you for doing that. So it's 8 o'clock in the morning. You're college students. My guess is you were up in the library pretty late last night. So I'll try to keep this engaging, and I realize we have a lot of different backgrounds, a lot of different experiences. Working with kids is a lot of different challenges or issues. And so what I want to talk to you today is a little bit, it's about our experience, kind of personal, kind of academic, about our experience getting to know our daughter and getting to know how to communicate with her, because it was not at all always clear to us that we'd be able to do so. So what I'll encourage you to do, because Nicole can certainly tell you this, no one wants to listen to me talk straight for about an hour. You'll understand that, and you probably already do. So interrupt with questions. Hey, you know, I've got a kid who presents this way. How would you address that? Let's make this as interactive as possible. One thing I know, because I want it to be a conversation, but I also wanted to respect the audience, I prepared a presentation. And I know that most presentations work better if they have the pictures of cute kids up. And so I'm biased to think my kids are pretty cute, so we'll use a lot of this image. Can I drop the lights, these lights at all? Is there any idea about that?
I'll give it a go.
All right.
Yeah, right on the wall.
So, so this is my wife, Legina, my older daughter, Stella, and Phoebe. It's one of the first pictures of Phoebe. Stella, it was, oh, perfect. Is that okay? All right. So Stella was, at this point, a kindergartner. She had been babysat by among the best in the business and had gone to preschool with some really good teachers and Nicole. And really wanted to be the first person to read a book to her younger sister. And we thought this was the most special thing ever. It wasn't until maybe a year or two later, when we're looking back at this picture, realized that Phoebe couldn't hear her reading to her. The good advantage of this, though, is the deafness, maybe one of the only advantages, is that when Phoebe was born, the song playing in the delivery room was Katy Perry's Fireworks. And it made me kind of sad. That was the first song my daughter was going to hear. I realized that she's about four. She didn't hear it. So that's a good thing. So our experience, just to personalize a little bit, because this is very personal for us, is that when Stella was born, it was pretty traumatic. She was born early, she was 4 pounds something, she had jaundice, she had a hole in the heart, she had an infection. But the most important thing was she had a really significant structural heart condition, aortic stenosis. And so when she was born, they hadn't even cleaned her off yet, and the doctor called the med student over and said, hey, come here, you gotta listen to this. I'm not the kind of doctor who helps people, according to my in-laws, but I do know enough to know that when the doctor says, hey, med student, come learn from this, it's not a good thing. Stella's life was not guaranteed. Things were really touch and go for a long time. She couldn't be around other kids for the first year. She couldn't get an infection. We had to be within an hour of a major medical center. She had 3 balloons in her heart by the time she was 11 months old. So when Phoebe was born, I'll tell you this, because and the doctors checked her out, because they knew this about this experience, they said, the doctor looked in the eyes and said, your daughter's perfect physically. And I didn't realize how much weight I'd been carrying around at that point. But it was probably, and I'll see him on the way down here, it may have been the happiest I've ever been. Stella was in jeopardy really the first 3 or 4 years for what they called an immediate catastrophic event, which just meant if she cried too hard, her heart could rupture, which was really stressful for parents, knowing your child could experience sudden death at almost any moment. Phoebe, we weren't going to have to worry about that. Phoebe, perfect physically. Great. We had no history of heart condition. We were talking about this earlier. We had no family history of hearing loss. And so I just great mood. So I go to the car when it's time to go. We didn't spend weeks in the ICU like we had with Phoebe. I installed a car seat, and right we're about to go, they tell us, oh, by the way, she was referred. She failed the newborn infant screening program, the universal infant screening program. Do you know what that is? Okay, so from the title, like, how would you explain it?
It's just a good way to check to see if there is hearing loss to prevent like a kid going years without being noticed.
Yeah, exactly. And it's transformative. It's Massachusetts one of the pioneers. It changed our lives. And so what they were able to do is they were able to say, hey, you're going home. By the way, your kid may not be able to hear, but it's probably fluid. We heard almost every parent, and now we're pretty well networked as parents of kids with hearing loss, have heard it's probably fluid. It often is, right? Of the statistically, I think, only 1 or 2 out of 1,000 kids live births that they test. It's not truly universal. Massachusetts is like 98% tested. About 1 or 2 of that 1,000 have hearing loss. Of those 1 or 2, a much smaller percentage have deafness or are deaf, like Phoebe is. And so it was understanding why the nurses might tell us, well, it's only probably fluid, but it turns out it wasn't. When we found out 3 weeks later, so we go home and we immediately start watching. Stella is loud. And we noticed that Phoebe just wasn't responding. And Legina started thinking about during her pregnancy, whenever Stella was around fireworks or around loud noises. My wife's an auctioneer. I'm getting a lot of emails, I'm sorry. I'm very popular. Because her students have been great with my stuff. No. Stella would kick a lot, but Phoebe never responded to the sound. And she's a good sleeper. She is a really good sleeper because she can't hear anything. So we're completely floored by this, and we didn't know what to do. I will always remember walking out. I remember the hand I had. Both my wife and I, we met the audiologist who diagnosed Phoebe's deafness. 3 weeks, we see her. She explains that she has bilateral severe profound hearing loss, which means that Phoebe's, with her natural hearing, would start hearing about 105 decibels. So if you were using a jackhammer and Phoebe was looking this way, she might be able to detect with her natural sound that there's something right there. If there were a jet engine where Nicole is, she might, if you were looking this way, she might not be able to know there's something behind her making sound. She's deaf. And we were trying to figure out what to do with that. I remember, both my wife and I remember to the stitch of clothing what the audiologist was wearing. And so I saw her 5 years later. You're the one, and you were wearing this and this and this and J. Crew shoes. And we knew it, and it really kind of freaked her out a little bit. We're friends. So we're four. We didn't know what to do. So what we did was, there's Phoebe at about 8 or 9 months. You'll see she's wearing a hearing aid. What we did is we got hooked up with an early intervention program. Now, any of you looking to work in the early intervention programs? Early childhood stuff, a couple, it's God's work. It changed our lives. So our early intervention program in Massachusetts is really good for this stuff. Our early intervention program gave us a lot of services. We went to, I live in Littleton, Mass, and so in the West Concord area, there's basically a hearing loss program, especially within early intervention. And it gave us sign-supported play groups. So we didn't know how to communicate with Phoebe. We had to sign, and so we had to learn sign. And so she's, from 3 months on, she's playing with peers and playing with trained specialists who are signing with her, giving her language, because everything we know is you have to get language in, doesn't matter what language it is, we have to get in there. She had speech therapy 3 times a week. Now, speech therapy originally was signing, but when she had the hearing aids, they started trying to stimulate her auditory nerve, because if we were going to do the cochlear implants, they had to make sure that it hadn't atrophied too much, right? You had to keep that pathway open. So when she had her hearing aids in, even though, because how do hearing aids work? Do we know anything about what they mechanically do? No? Okay. So hearing aids are simply just amplification. They're not processing the sound. They're catching sound, making it louder, and forcing the louder sound through the ear canal to the auditory nerve and the cochlea. So when she has hearing aids on, she had a little bit of residual hearing, right? So with hearing aids, she could go from starting sound at 105 decibels, jet engine jackhammer, to about 70, 80 decibels, which is about the sound of my voice right now if she's right there, right? So she could detect sound if I were looking right at her with the hearing aids on, she could detect sound, 2 or 3 feet away, but she was never going to get language from it. So So those of you who are studying early childhood stuff or trying to help kids kind of develop their capabilities, language is what's so important. And so the analogy they use for us that made so much sense is that when Phoebe was, you've been to swimming pools, right? So Phoebe wearing hearing aids, it's like one of y'all being on the bottom of a swimming pool and someone turns on the radio or starts playing music or whatever it is. You can tell there's music out there. You can maybe hear the dum, dum, dum. You know, I know Nicole really used to love Justin Bieber. She's really, like t-shirts, it was embarrassing how much she loved Justin Bieber. Maybe I'm misremembering, but let's just go with that. You know, so you know, it's, you've got all that, you know, baby, baby, baby. She'd sing it all the time. That may have been but you know, you could hear that, but she would never pick up lyrics. So Phoebe would never be able to have spoken language through hearing aids. But they allow us to keep the auditory nerves functioning. And one thing we had to do, we had to get CAT scans and MRIs and everything to make sure that her internal anatomy might be receptive. So she wears these, she's getting speech therapy, and they're trying to teach her these six kind of fundamental sounds. They're called the lean sound, E, I, you know, just different sounds, just trying to get her used to hearing them. We had parent support groups, which turned out to be really important for us. I never thought I was a support group kind of guy. It turns out I am. Part of what we do is I'm the president of the Decibels Foundation now, which is a nonprofit, is try to plant support groups around the state. Because there's so much you can learn from other parents who've walked this walk before. Parent sign language classes, I had to learn how to sign. If we're going to give our daughter language, we had to be able to give her language, and we didn't have it. So one thing we did is we used parent sign language classes, and the Mass Commission for the Deaf and Hard of Hearing will send, if you're working with families, they will send from birth to 3 months, if 3 years, they have a child with hearing loss diagnosis, even if it's just a mild moderate. They'll send someone for 20 weeks to give you basically sign language 101 and 102 to come to your house, 2.5 hour lessons, learn how to sign. We also had just kick-ass parent mentors. And from them, we learned so much. But especially what we learned is we're going to be able to communicate with our kids. It may be through sign, it may be through spoken language, maybe through a combination. It may not always be the same, but we'd figure out a way that, and what we learned is, you know, kids are kids. You know, she's happy. She's looking at like some Disney princess or something here. And she likes it. She's having fun. She can't hear anything. She likes it. But the other thing is we did, we had vicarious experiences, all the stuff I think that many of you are probably trained to do. We got to see families go through their IEPs, go through their transitions, argue with principals, think about which districts are good, which ones are bad. And what we learned is that it's not at all correlated with the affluence of the district. Like we always assumed rich districts, better services, poor districts, less advanced services. It's really tough to predict. It's almost personality based. So if you can go to a district with that person, then you're probably going to get services. If you can go to another district with someone else, then you may be in for a lawsuit to get your kids what they needed. So this is Phoebe in speech therapy session. She's eating the little mouse instead of hearing the sound. So, what do you know about cochlear implants? Who's heard of cochlear implants? Okay, we all heard of them. Who's seen them? Some of you seen them? Is there, there's a student in the clinic, okay. Do you know how they work? They're not hearing aids. Phoebe's ears are decorative. They're beautiful ears, but you can't see them, they're all covered up. Like, those are nice, handsome ears, right? She's got her daddy's ears. But they don't work. They're decorative. They've got, like, where you have 10,000 hairs in each ear that are collecting sound, turning the electrical impulses, and transmitting that into our internal anatomy to make it work. It just doesn't work for her. It doesn't happen. So what she does, what we decided to do, after a lot of decision-making, because it's a big decision, to say, I'm going to do surgery on your kid's head twice. Phoebe had two different surgeries. The protocol 5 years ago was to do them one at a time. Now they'll do it bilaterally. That's an 8-hour surgery. What we decided to do is go with the cochlear implant surgery, so that gave her the best access to her sound, and then she would get to choose which language, if she wanted to go to spoken or sign language. So the surgery, the way it works, is that they cut behind the ear and peel back the skin. They drill a hole into the skull and make a little cave there. And in the cave, they implant a magnet and an internal processor. So the implant is actually the thing that's there. The thing's in the external part is the processor that Phoebe wears. And then they basically hardwire it. If you've taken A&P anatomy classes. All right, so behind the ear, there's pretty big gap where you can actually thread things through there. It's a delicate surgery because those are the nerves that control like kind of facial muscles, so if they or and taste. Like so if they hit the wrong nerve, you can lose taste and ability, like Bell's palsy forever. It's nothing you do lightly. We have friends who've had the cochlear implant surgery, and they have gushers. Their vestibular aqueduct starts gushing spinal fluid, which is nothing you want for your 10-month-old kid to be gushing spinal fluid. It's a pretty traumatic-looking surgery, but kids bounce back really quickly. So this is Phoebe after both her surgeries. You can see she's a little older here. She had this one when she was, 14 months, and this one when she was about 17 months. The processor is the part she wears in her ear. Do you have a kid with the, okay. So that's a little computer with a big magnet attached to it, and it has two microphones on top. The microphone collects sound, and the computer translates the sound to electrical impulses. Then she's got, you can't see it here, I'll show you another picture. There's a little wire that comes up, and a magnet sticks in her head. First of all, that's pretty awesome. She can stick spoons, she can stick Coke cans, she can stick things to her head, and that's what come in handy in middle school. But the magnet to her head, the computer communicates through the internal thing, through the skin membrane, because where the magnet holds onto. And you have to adjust as a parent if you're really careful not to have the magnet too tight, because then it'll compress the skin, and it'll destroy the skin, you've got all kinds of infections. If it's too loose, it falls off all the time, then she doesn't have access to sound. But then what it does is once it gets there, then it's hardwired, like I said, and down through the behind the ear to the cochlea, and it just bypasses the part that doesn't work. And then once it's in there, it starts transmitting sound. Now, it's not the same sound we hear. It's not. She doesn't hear like us. It's the only sound she's ever had, so it seems natural to her. It would be really off-putting to us. There's stimulators out there where you can listen to it, like on YouTube and stuff, but it sounds like a cyborg from an 80s movie talking to you. I don't know if that's how it sounds to her or not, but she has normal sounding, typical sounding speech. She has, it takes her a while. And this would probably be a tough environment for her. I'm trying to walk on the carpet more than the hardwood, because this is really distracting with hearing loss, right? The acoustics are probably pretty good with acoustical panels in here. So if she's sitting in the back, it's going to be tough. Have you taken classes about like ESLs? Any education? Okay. Those of you who are want to be teachers, think about teachers, there's kind of like four or five categories of students who are learning English as a second language. And one of the things you do, if you're teaching students in that, learning English as a second language, some of you may be those students, is that there's a processing time. Where even if someone is learning English and knows English pretty well, it's the same like if you're taking class in Spanish or Italian or German or whatever language you speak, Vietnamese, it takes you a second, okay, I got that, okay, I know what it means, now I can respond. Phoebe, it takes longer for sound to get to her computer, be translated, go up there, then go back in, she's taking a bypass, and it takes a while for her. This is an activation video. This is her second one. You can see how she's communicating with her audiologist, and that's again, it's my wife. She wants more.
Yes.
The idea is to play the game when she hears something to look up. Oh, and she looks over and she sees a fish. That's this purple fish.
Do you hear that?
Yes!
Oh, I had a fish! Yay! I had a fish! Good job! Beautiful!
There you go. It's like riding a bike.
She said, where's the fish? Where is it?
Good signing.
Oh my gosh.
her, she's got the muff, muff. She's got the more sound. Her, the muff, muff.
Okay, or she may just start to brush. Like she
okay, so what's happened so far is the first part she was doing it, and they were simulating her sound with the computer. So we're, there weren't sounds we were hearing. So when the audiologist said, oh, good job, Phoebe wasn't hearing that, because one ear was just deaf, and the other ear is plugged into the computer. It's not getting external sound. Now you'll see she's wearing it on her head. She's getting external sound. She's still signing. She's got some muh. She's learned enough to say muh. She's learned that sound. She's learned how to make it with her mouth. Now she's wearing a prosthetic.
So and she's getting that through her right ear too now? It's pretty awesome.
She turned right to the fish right when it went off. That face was very
good. Got the fish.
That was cute. And she's like, that's good. She's taller than you. You guys, these are great.
That's right.
Again, I know that I said that this was for her first activation for the first time, but this is like a perfect activation. She's wearing it. She turned to the fish when it came on. You guys, she's doing amazing.
It was a tough day. Really emotional as a parent. Anyway, as an educator, it was a tough day. She bounced back quickly. It's a long day for the parents, too. But it wasn't clear to us which language she would choose. She now has access to sound. We'll have choices she's going to be able to choose. So I took her to, my wife had to work in New York, so I took my girls down there, and we went to the Museum of Natural History. And she loved looking at dinosaurs, and we'd seen pictures of dinosaurs. She's a kid, right? And she's wearing her implant here. And I said, she's just so weird. She's like pointing at the dinosaurs all the time. And I talked to my wife that night. She goes, no, you idiot. That's a sign for dinosaur. And I realized that she was signing dinosaur all the time. She had language, but I didn't. Wasn't paying attention to it. One of the things I was telling Nicole earlier is that when I was, one time I was standing with her at early intervention, and I was just standing by a bookshelf talking to somebody, and Phoebe was kind of pointing at the shelves, and someone said, you know what she's doing, right? I said, yeah, she's probably wetting her diaper. I don't know what's going on. And she goes, no, she's babbling. She's babbling with her hands. The only language she knew was sign language, and she was trying to communicate with us. But I didn't know it. I didn't recognize what she was doing. One thing we did as parents is we contacted a couple of deaf schools and got deaf babysitters to come in and give her a language experience. Just sign with her all day long, just all day long, all day long, all day long. This may be our life. She needs a language. She needs language. So here's her signing that. This is same picture before. This is a video. I think I'll show part of this one if we have time. This is her in our very messy kitchen. Around two, I don't know the exact age, when she's learning the alphabet, but she's learning it two different ways. So this is her signing and saying the alphabet. Show you this one in the interest of time, I think. Well, maybe we have time. This one's one. Actually, I think I will. Are we okay with the videos? All right. So this is a video of her at her second birthday party, and so she had sound through the cochlear implants for almost 8 or 9 months. Right, and you see his activation, you think people get sound, they're going to start hearing. So this is us singing happy birthday to her, but we're all signing it to her, and then watch how she responds at the end. Like, see which language she's trying to use.
So you leave, so we can watch you, ready?
Here
we go, ready?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Phoebe. Happy birthday.
doesn't say thank you. She responds in sign language. Yeah.
What's her name?
Her name sign is you make a P, and this is actually her. So her name sign is Phoebe.
Yeah.
Phoebe and her sister's Stella. I originally wanted it to be Phoebe because the way naming conventions, you know this in sign language. So what you often do is you can make it up, and so for me it's probably like Brad Dad. Male things are up here. Female things are usually around the chin, because when American Sign Language was really coming into its fruition and maturation in the late 1800s, men often wore hats with brims, and so daddy, grandpa, you know, son, like that. Female stuff, because they often wore bonnets, are like strings. So Phoebe is P for girl, Phoebe. I wanted to do Phoebe in my heart, but I realized I felt like I was doing like gang signs, or like I was like a middle-aged white guy acting like using gang signs, and because I like wanted to like peace out or something. It's not gonna work. So I knew myself well enough not to give her the Phoebe. The other thing, just so you know, is like you saw me, like I bounce signs. Like, oh, no, 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 or yes, 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 or more. I told you I have deaf babysitters. This may not be, I hope this is an appropriate story. So I was trying to be a good host. Do you want something to eat? Are you hungry? Do you know what I'm doing? So hungry is one, it turns out.
Yeah.
If you do it more than once, do you know what it means?
Yeah.
Like hungry for love. So I'm asking this 19-year-old deaf babysitter in my house, and she's sitting on my couch. How are you doing? You know, it's completely inappropriate. And she made very clear that that's not what I'm supposed to do. So hungry, and stop there. Stop there. Right there. Yeah.
I had a question. Did you start with like baby sign language first?
Yeah.
Because she's like really advanced already.
Well, that was her language, is the thing.
Yeah.
So we were doing baby sign. In fact, my sign level was, I communicate with 3-year-olds. But now I'm the president of the foundation, I should be able to have more advanced conversations. I'm really not that skilled at it. You know, I was talking to Cole earlier. Phoebe has gravitated. She would say thank you. She wouldn't do this. She has chosen spoken language as her primary language. But she still has receptive signs still really important to her. Because when those things are off, or the battery's not working, or she's at school, or something like that, and the processor aren't working, the world's on mute. It's quiet. Nothing. And so we still need to be able to sign with her. Oftentimes it's, you need to go to bed now. I said, now. Did you hear me? Now. Like that. Or, you know, please, or, you know, where's your dinosaur, or whatever it is. So we do a lot of just basic signing with her about that. You know, how are you? But her responses are she expresses language verbally now instead of her signing isn't great. Because that's just what she does. So we'll sign with her in the morning before she puts the processors in. At night when she takes them off. In the bath and at swimming pools when it's raining. Sometimes in the car when it's real road noise. At restaurants when it's loud, she'll just take them off. Sometimes what she'll do, you'll appreciate this as people work with kids, is like, one time my wife was trying to, she was on timeout or something, and she looked at her and said, I can't hear you now, Mommy. It's funny, right? Until it happens to you. Because then they'll say, all right, you need to, and she goes, and she's going like this. And then she, after a while, she'll come back on, are you still talking? So part of what we want to do is, so part of the main lesson of the early intervention program is we want our kid to be able to self-advocate. Because school's tough for her. Right? It is. She seems to have a lot of natural ability, but we're working with her. And things are going to be tough with her. I saw a parent, a group where a middle schooler was talking about it and said that, look, all the good things in middle school happen in places where I can't hear. Like bus, cafeteria, hallway, gym, dances. Like, that's where the important stuff in middle school happens. And just can't hear. So it's going to be tough for her. And so we need her to be able to advocate. It's just not necessarily to me when she's doing something wrong. Like, the I can't hear you now. We told other parents of deaf kids, oh, she's doing that early? You're in trouble. So, yeah, we know that. So, other questions? Yeah?
Does she go to a deaf school or a
She doesn't. And one of the things I want to talk about in a second is kind of, because I figured some of y'all are future educators, is how we made the decision. So, as you can see, what's going on here? That's not on my screen. That's what happened to Salem City. Ta-da! There we go. So actually, anticipating your question. So she's a kid. She has fun. She loves to play in leaves. She has $27,000 of brown, small electronics attached to her head. I don't like it when she helps me rake her leaves. Because those things are really important. If she loses one, it's expensive, and it means she can't hear, which is not ideal. This is one of the best days of my life. I was sitting there grading, she was sitting there helping me, and she was playing with that thing, and she just realized all of a sudden, because we are gradually, when you have to process this, you gradually turn up the sound. It's like you've been living in a cave for 5 years. You don't just turn on the lights. You gradually, so you're not blinking at it. She said, "Daddy, this makes sound." She had played with those things for a year and never known they made sound. So that day she heard it, and then she loved it. And you can see how happy she is. You can't believe it. These things make sound when you pop them. Yeah, that's the whole point. But she didn't know. One of the parents we know of a kid who's deaf and hasn't been implanted, wasn't able to, asked her one time, "What sound do rainbows make?" There's something that beautiful in nature. Waterfalls, she knows, make sound. Why don't rainbows have to make sounds? Right? If you don't have that sense, whatever the sense is, you might assume it's there for people. She didn't know these made sounds. That guy assumed rainbows did. It's interesting. So she loves to go to the beach. You notice the color of the sand? Did I mention the color of the processors? One thing I found when you're in working with, if you're in the deaf community or working with kids with hearing loss, is that most people are really open to asking questions, answering questions. So if you're working with kids who are in hearing aids or have hearing loss, you can ask their family the question. So I was in the line at an ice cream shop, and there is a college-age kid, someone about your kid age, in front of me. And this young woman, but she had the cochlear implants. Hey, can we talk about this? My daughter, she was telling me the beach. I said, beach. I don't know what to do with the beach. Just take them off. Because, if I had a microphone right now and I just kept blowing on it, what kind of sound would that make for you in the speakers? It'd be really annoying, right? That's what the wind of the beach does the entire time she's there, she said. So just take them off. Sign with her. It'll be good. Phoebe loves the beach. She's never really heard the waves when she plays them. She's good. We sign with her. The problem is she's fast, and when she takes off, you have to get in front of her to tell her to stop, because she can't yell at her. So you have to watch her look pretty close to there. She has a personality that she's able to express. This is a video I want to show real quickly to show how far she's come. This is part of her, she did summer school last year, and this is part of the curriculum was on the senses. When I first heard that, I said, "Oh, here we go. How are we doing that?" Because this is what she came out and read to me. The day before, she had done the self-advocacy. She'd done a presentation about cochlear implants and kind of explained how they work. So she could take them apart and explain to the teachers, that kind of thing. This is her reading as a, I guess, preschooler at this point.
And here by Phoebe. I can hear a plane in the sky. I can hear a bird tweet. I can hear a sprinkler. I can hear feet walking. I can hear mom say, "I love you."
Good job, baby.
Jack, let me watch that video.
It always gets to me. Because one of those moms a couple years ahead of us who had a kid with implants, when Phoebe went in for surgery, the kid was probably 3 and a half. They'd written her a little note. "Dear Phoebe, I hope you can see, I hope you'll be able to hear the birds and the tree and the leaves in the trees." Because Phoebe didn't know that it made sounds. We go for a walk, we have to stop. "Where's the airplane? Where's the airplane?" And we look for it. And now she hears it. It's pretty damn amazing. These are some of the services we use and that you as caregivers might want to help your families access. You should know about University we're here in Spring. The Minuteman ARC Early Intervention Program. The Decibels Foundation, which pays for the Minuteman ARC program, so it's free of cost to anybody who can get there. Shared Reading Program is a program at Northern Essex, and there's one in South Shore too, I think in Plymouth, where they teach parents of kids with hearing loss how to read books to their kids, how to sign specific books, the mechanics of sitting with somebody, you know, you want a kid in your lap, you're sitting there, how do you hold the book and sign and support your kid at the same time? It's logistically challenging. These are things that I've never thought about before. Babysitters from deaf programs. The Learning Center in Framingham is one of the nation's best deaf schools. We'll get to that. I remember that question. It's an ASL class of babysitters. Department of Deaf and Hard of Hearing program at Children's Hospitals, all kinds of gatherings. The Mass Commission for Deaf and Hard of Hearing was an advocate for us, so we had to reject our IEP and fight to see if we can get appropriate education. They had someone there who was sitting in the room with us and gave us a backbone. Hear My Dream support groups. There are other parent support groups that we still go to. The HHP, again, for clinical appointments and reports to share to schools. There's all kinds of things. So this is Phoebe dressed as... Who is she dressed as? Shirley Temple at an event with this kid is also has hearing loss. So our experience in the schools. Some are watching fireworks. And fireworks, they're amazing, right? Some have been frustrated. It's in Salem. So our IEP process was, we went 3 years in early intervention program. 2.9 years, whatever it is. We were transitioning out. She was still dependent a lot on sign. And they were just going to put her in regular preschool half a day. We said, that's not enough. And so we rejected the IEP. We were pushing for a placement in deaf school because it still wasn't clear to us. I mean, she needed sign support almost continuously. She needed sign. Like, when we were talking, we were really trying to sign the whole time. She could not, cannot pick up like vocab and songs, or she can't pick up the lyrics. There's things she doesn't have discrimination skills. We'd reject. Turns out my school district actually had someone on staff that was trained as a teacher of the deaf. But they weren't going to put her in her classroom. They said, we've got her. It doesn't help us if she's across the building, across the room, across the hall. So what they ended up doing is having to reconfigure the entire way they structure the preschool so she could be in class with that woman. They went for half a day, and they realized, hey, your daughter's needs are much more complex than we knew. I said, yeah. And so after about 3 months, we shifted to a full day, 5 day, with a lot of pre-services and after-services. Her morning teacher was trained as a teacher of deaf. Her afternoon teacher was trained as a speech therapist who also signed. And so we were able to say that's probably appropriate. But otherwise, it would have been, you know, we were on the road to lawsuit or to mediation. Because we knew what she needed. So I had some suggestions for y'all who work, maybe you will work with these kids, just to kind of include this. There she is at Children's Hospital. If you're working in an educational setting, ask the educational audiologist. They'll help you figure out, you know, what the room should look like. Recognize that hearing aids aren't the same as cochlear implants we talked about before. Preview and review. Whatever you're doing, so if you're working with kids with hearing loss, they're not going to pick up the vocabulary in a big group setting. They're not going to pick up the rules. If you ask them, did you hear me, they'll say yes. Did you understand me? The answer may very well be no. If you're working in the gym, which I think a lot of you do, worst acoustical environment possible. It's tough for hearing people to pay attention to lock in gyms. Kids with hearing loss, it's multiple times more difficult. So it's eye level, it's eye contact. My daughter reads lips, and that's really important. And you know, these sorts of things, ask the experts, get the expert how to do it. The social part of school, the social part of play is really difficult for her. One of the things, the main things, her IEP was how she played with others in the playground. Why do you think that'd be tough? Why is it tough for kids with hearing loss to connect? Yeah.
Other children aren't aware of it, so they don't know if they'll be at eye level and talk.
Right.
They're running around.
They're running around. Mm-hmm. They often don't articulate clearly. They often have higher voices, which for Phoebe and most people with hearing loss, a deeper register actually is easier to hear. You may have heard people with what they call deaf speech. You know, people who either got access to sound later, or they, it's often deeper, it's deeper in the throat because the vibrations, you can feel it. But also it's just, you know, if you're out playing, people are doing stuff. Like, we're talking, you know, we're playing here, but then someone says, and now I'm a pirate, and you're a princess, and here we go, right? But she can't hear that, because you're talking the other direction, the wind's blowing. So Phoebe, up until this year, really, did a lot of parallel play, or if she were on the playground, she wanted to do, is let's play pick up acorns. Let's play something where we can be next to each other, but I don't have to listen to you. The other problem is that often deaf kids, or kids with hearing loss, can be bossy, because that way they control things. They don't have to worry about what they're missing. And so this is something just to be aware of. If there's a kid with hearing loss who may be a little pushy or a little bit annoying, it's a good chance that kid's compensating and just trying to stay involved, but also not feel like he or she's missing everything. Hallways, gyms, buses, cafeterias are the worst. Usual accommodations may not be right for these kids. Those future educators, future teachers in the room. All right, one of the things you'll learn in IEPs, one of the standard accommodations is preferential seating. Right? So preferential seating often means kind of front, it's right here. But for Phoebe, it means she can't be seated near the sink. Because that turning on that someone over there bouncing around, turning on water, turning it off, goes from 50 decibels to 80 decibels. She can't hear with the white noise. It's thinking about, and that's where working with the audiologist really matters. You need to be comfortable with the expensive equipment, because that's how the kids get access to sound. And a little signing can help all of them. You know, just bathroom? Okay. Yes? No. I use it with my students all the time, but they don't sign. And so it's weird. So, like, you come talk to me and I'm talking to a student here, I can tell you to wait. But that's a weird gesture to give a student, right? It's like, I'm going to tickle you. It's inappropriate. It doesn't happen. Bridgewater, I'm sure. You know, that's weird. Or someone says, yeah. Same. I'm with you. I'm feeling you. Right? But that's also a weird gesture, right? Just, yeah. Or just someone will say something, I'll go, and just, no, that's weird. I'll have students come in and ask me a question. I'll go, yeah. You know, just yes, no, nodding head, no. But it's one of those things, it's weird. If someone's going, yeah, I won't say it, I'll just sign it. And they'll just look at me like, who is this weird dude? So these are some of my suggestions. Phoebe loved Vegas. I mean, most little kids would. She really wanted her picture taken with the fancy girls. Because Vegas is visual. And she loved it. And so I know we're on a schedule. I think we've actually got a little bit of time. I hope that was helpful. I think most of you stayed awake, which I don't think is a victory, after having the colon class.
I stayed awake.
Don't guarantee. No, it's not guaranteed. What questions do you have, or do you have any questions? Yeah.
Did you ever consider going back to school to understand the auditory processes better?
You know, I have a sense I think I understand it pretty well for a layperson. I have buddies who are cardiologists, I have buddies who are ENTs. I can talk hearts and ears at a pretty sophisticated level for a layperson, I think. Just because it's been my world. You want to talk gallbladders? I got nothing for you. And I can't tell you which bone is which bone in the foot. But I can talk ears, not talk hearts. And part of that, Phoebe, I guess here's the last thing I would say without being prompted by a question, is Phoebe has had every advantage possible. She lives in Massachusetts. She was born at a time when cochlear implants, for pediatric cochlear implants, were becoming more routine. She has two parents who are in a loving, stable relationship. She has two parents who speak English as the first language. She has two parents who have graduate degrees. Who are not intimidated by doctors and actually been through more medical trauma than this. So once we figured out, once we got over the bumps, we figured out how to make it ride. We have the most supportive network possible. We have good insurance. My job is flexible. She has every advantage possible, and she's thriving. Our challenge as society is to make sure every kid has that advantage, right? Because she's going to be able to reach her potential. She has no excuses. I shudder to think what happened if we didn't have those advantages. My job didn't allow that flexibility. If I didn't have good health insurance, if we didn't speak English as a first language, if we were, because this can tear a couple apart too. We've seen families divorce over parents responding differently to it. Phoebe's going to be able to do whatever she can do, whatever she has the willpower to do, because she has had every possible advantage given to her. But a lot of kids don't. And your job as caregivers, as educators, as support team, is to make sure these kids get their chance. And I think it's a real important job, and I appreciate y'all doing it, because she deserves it. She's funny. She's smart. She's cute. She's willful. All these things. Yeah.
Was this hard on your other daughter as well, getting her attention off of her?
I think so. It's Stella's a good kid. We're really lucky with her. She started the sign language club in her school. We have a lot of things for Phoebe. But I tell Stella, we did a lot more for you. You just don't remember. And so in that case, having two major medical problems has been beneficial. I don't think it's been different for her, but I don't know if it's been a necessarily a challenge. Like, she actually learned sign language, which was so frustrating. For the sign language classes, when the person would come to our house. So the first day, there's a speaker with her, and so there's a translator. After that, it's a deaf woman in her house teaching a sign language as an immersion experience. So my wife and I'd be locked in. I'm kind of type A. I'd be studying. I'd be ready. And my Stella would be over there on the couch, barely paying attention. Stella, I got his family. You know, she just, her mind is a sponge. She was just picking up more quickly than we were. Sometimes we do things for Phoebe. You know, I'm involved in this foundation that we're not as involved in the American Heart Association for Stella, you know, such leadership roles. Stella gets her time. But it's a parenting challenge, yeah. Yeah.
Does Stella ever act as a translator?
Yeah. Yeah, Stella, she's a big sister. She's a good kid, big sister. She's got Phoebe's back. Unless Stella's friends are over, and then she wants her out of her room and just shut up. So she's a big sister. Yeah.
When did you realize that Phoebe was choosing more verbal language versus sign language?
It was about the time we were trying to decide where to send her to school. So a year and a half after the implant surgeries. So probably 2.5, 2.75. Now part of that could be just because that was the environment. 90%, statistics may know, 90% of deaf kids are born to parents who hear. And so there are many more kids now that the option is available of getting the implants. So there's kind of a big deaf, it's a different conversation, right? But in kind of deaf culture, deaf world, there's a lot of discussion about trends that goes. But so, because she was in an environment where she was surrounded by sound and speaking people, I think that might have helped her kind of gravitational pull her in that direction. If we had been a signing family, she probably would have gone that way. But the main thing is that we've now realized that would have been fine too. You know, we would have figured it out. It's like if your kid's born and your kid can only speak Chinese, well, then you learn Chinese, right? Because you want to, you learn Mandarin, you know, whatever it is. You learn a dialect, Cantonese. You learn it because you want to communicate with your kids. Going to early intervention, working with folks like kind of the professions you're going to have, helped us figure out that, yeah, we'll have the resources to do what we need to do to support our kid. Look at the clock. Other questions? I think y'all have actually kids to go support now.
Well, thank you so much.
Oh, thanks.
We have CPDC. Here's a nifty t-shirt.
Oh, a nifty t-shirt.
See? But